I don't have it down yet, but good morning and welcome to the 10:02 service at the Union Church of South Foxborough. It's great to be here with those of you in person and those of you who are watching through our website or Facebook Live. We are together in the Holy Spirit. We are one church. Wherever we may be in our homes, we are one church through God's Son, Jesus Christ. Special good morning to Stephen, who's watching from his group home. We love you, Stephen. We miss you. We'll be back together soon. And that goes to for all of you as well who are watching. Psalm 63 says, O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you. In a dry and weary land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary or the backyard and beheld your power and your glory, because your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. Could we pray together? Father, thank you that we may gather in this place or electronically from wherever we may be. Thank you that your Holy Spirit is with each and every one of us. Receive our worship as we lend our voice to all those around the world who praise and bless your name. Thank you for the beauty of your creation, which reminds us of your purity, your perfect motives, your great love for all humanity. Receive our worship today and lead it by your Holy Spirit, we pray, in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. We're going to have a song. Faith is going to sing for us this morning, and this is her last Sunday for right now with us. I just want to say how grateful we are for her helping us in our worship all summer. So, Faith.
Come, thou font of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it, name of God's redeeming love. Hitherto thy love hast blessed me, thou hast brought me to this place. And I know thy hand will bring me safely home by thy good grace. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, bought me with his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Powerful, beautiful voice. Powerful words. Jesus sought me when a stranger. He came looking for us. And because his character is like that, and because he cares for us, we can go to him in prayer. And we normally take a moment of our service to pray for some prayer requests. We have a baby in our church family, and we've never met him. He was born at the beginning of COVID, but baby Owen, you may know his big sister Riley, and his parents, Bill and Michelle, have asked for prayer for Owen. We prayed for him when he was a few weeks old because he was having trouble gaining weight, and he's now fallen below where they want him. So we're going to pray this morning for baby Owen and remember him during the week too, that he would gain the weight. We want a healthy boy. He's a beautiful baby. Patty McNutt has asked us to continue to pray for her cousin Rebecca, who had bad burns several months ago. She's evidently going to need some skin grafting, but they aren't doing it yet because of COVID. So continue to pray for her. Patty also asked for prayer for a man named Stephen, who is having health issues. We prayed for him a few weeks ago. She asks that we would continue. I have a couple praises. In the 8 o'clock service, we have a lady named Shirley who comes, and her husband Bill had been having health issues. He's much improved, so we thank the Lord for that. Also, during this week, we normally pray for people in recovery from alcohol or drug addiction. Many of our families are affected by that, our communities are. And a young lady connected with friends of mine was in very bad shape. She had an infection in her body from drug use, and she was in ICU, unconscious, but God answers prayer, and she's doing very well. And other people we prayed for in recovery are currently doing well, so we'll remember them again this morning. So could we pray together for a moment for some of these requests? Before I pray, also, I have a word of thanks I'm forgetting from Fran, our deacon out at the table, and Fred. They're thankful for all the cards, all the phone calls, all the offers of help, all the kindness the church family has showed them. And Fred is continuing to progress. He's continuing with physical therapy now on an outpatient basis. So continue to pray for Fred, but they're doing well, and they're grateful for the love of the church family. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we may worship you today. And you are not a God who is distant. You're not a God who set up the universe on mathematical formulas and then stepped away to see what would take place. But you are a God who is personal. You are a God who knows all that's happening all around the world, and yet you know what's happening in each of our lives as well. And because you are infinite, there is maybe an infinite number of people, and you're aware of each of us as individuals. Thank you today that we live in a universe that is governed by a God who is holy, who is righteous, a God who is wise and majestic in his character and his motives and all that he does, and has revealed himself clearly to us in the pages of Scripture as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And because you are personal and because you love, we bring before you some of our many requests this morning. Father, many of our church families are going through personal and difficult situations. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you would be with them and with each individual. Father, grant that you would work in those things that we cannot share, but, Father, that are heavy on our hearts, that there might be reconciliation, there might be hope, there might be amendment of life and ways. Father, do your great work, we pray, in answer to our prayers, whether public or private. We pray for the Kleindienst today. Fred and Fran, continue, Father, to bring healing to Fred's body and grant him strength and give Fran endurance as she cares for him so faithfully. Father, be with baby Owen. We desire this child to be healthy and at the weight that he should be and unhindered. Father, touch his body, that nutrition may be processed, that appetite may be great. Grant him health, grant him wellness as you have in answer to our prayers before, and bless his big sister Riley and watch over her as well. Father, we continue to pray for those in recovery. Thank you for answers to prayer even this week. Many meet on this property seeking you as the source of recovery and wellness. That's true for all of us. Father, be the answer and reveal yourself. May healthy steps be taken by those in crisis for the sustenance of life and well-being. Father, we continue to pray for this country, for we are in great need as a nation. We are divided. We are showing every sign of spiritual difficulty and turning away from you. Father, do a great work of spiritual renewal in this country, that we might be drawn together at the foot of your throne in humility, and we might love one another as people, and we might see your hand again upon our nation in a whole new way. And Father, we worship you together by praying as Jesus taught his disciples, whose Father, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I have announcements to share with you. Probably the first three you have memorized by now if you're regularly watching or coming in person. Wednesday night we have Zoom. We are on Zoom. If you have a computer or a smartphone, you can join us. We've been studying the book of James. It's taken us 3 weeks, but we've gotten through the first chapter. We're getting a lot out of it. There's a lot of great discussion by the group, so you are invited. If you need the link, let me know Wednesday at 7 p.m. If we have a Sunday, which we have not all summer, I don't think, when it's raining, we will be live stream only. However, you may or may not know, but in May we had a virtual annual meeting of the church. We approved our church budget, but we haven't concluded our annual meeting. We have to appoint our officers, and we have a slate prepared for that. And that meeting will be on September 3rd, it's a Thursday, at 6:30 p.m., a little bit earlier than usual because we're going to do a hybrid meeting. If you wish to come and be here in person and social distance, you're welcome to do so, like some of us are right now. We'll also be live streaming on Facebook. We will also have a laptop set up with Zoom. And we'll also be discussing what will we do, when do we as a church feel safe using the building, and how will we do that? Will we live stream during the colder months on Sunday and have small groups in the fellowship hall? We want everybody to be heard, including Corrine, who takes the lead on cleaning the building, making sure it's safe for us. So we want to have a discussion about that. That's September 3rd at 6:30 p.m. The leadership group that's been studying this issue since March will probably make the final decision, but we do want everyone's input. We want the community involved. And by the way, to come to annual meeting at Union Church, you don't have to be a member. We have a long tradition of friends coming also, so everyone is invited. If you'd like to follow along in your Bible or on your phone, we will be looking today. We've been doing our series. Got to practice drinking water so I don't choke up again. We've been doing a series from the Gospel according to John, and today we'll be in chapter 14, beginning at verse 15 to the end of the chapter. John chapter 14, beginning at verse 15 to the end of the chapter. Albert Einstein set a benchmark as perhaps the highest IQ of those living in his lifetime. And he gave many talks at scientific gatherings and so on. And he had a chauffeur who would bring him to these events. And a chauffeur said to him one time, "Dr. Einstein, I've heard you give this same talk so many times, I think I could give it." So when they arrived at the scientific conference, they switched places. The chauffeur dressed as Einstein and went up on stage. Einstein sat in the back in the chauffeur's uniform. And sure enough, the chauffeur, posing as Albert Einstein, gave the exact talk, word for word, flawlessly. At the very end, there was another scientist who was a rival of Dr. Einstein. So probably to trip him up, he stood up and he asked the chauffeur Einstein a very difficult question. The chauffeur Einstein stood there looking for a moment, and then he said, "That question is so easy, I'm going to ask my chauffeur in the back to answer that question for me." Albert Einstein set a benchmark in the world of mathematics and the theory of relativity. Almost 100 years ago now, Babe Ruth set the real single-season benchmark in 154 games, 60 home runs in 1927. The Dow Jones is very often quoted for the stock market, but it's really the S&P 500 that's 500 companies that is a stock benchmark with a bigger pool of companies. Abraham Lincoln set the benchmark of presidential leadership according to generation after generation of U.S. history historians. Benchmarks are a high standard, a standard we can aspire to. We could call them the gold standard or something we reach to, a record we seek to break. And in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, it was Holy Week, the final week leading up to his crucifixion. And you may or may not recall that Jesus, at the beginning of John chapter 13, made a pivot away from his public ministry. He had been speaking for 3 years publicly, giving his teaching publicly, being confronted by the religious leaders publicly. He had done all his miracles and his amazing works publicly. But now in chapter 13, beginning at verse 1, he had pivoted and began spending his final week before the crucifixion with his disciples in private, giving them his final instruction before his death and resurrection. And away from the crowds, he had washed their feet to teach them something about servant leadership and what it meant to be a follower of his and be a leader. He revealed that he knew perfectly well that Judas Iscariot would betray him. And then he set a benchmark. He set a standard that if we are a genuine believer in Christ, we are to follow. And he says it in the passage that we're going to read. It wasn't a 700-pound bench press. It wasn't a 4-minute mile. It was something far more important. See if you can catch it in John chapter 14, beginning at verse 15. The standard to which Jesus calls his true followers. Jesus says, beginning at verse 15, this is Jesus speaking, "If you love me, you will obey what I have commanded you. And you will ask, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth." He means the Holy Spirit. "The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one," and that's generic, "he or she, is the one who truly loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, there were two disciples named Judas, the other Judas, the less famous Judas, said, but Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus replied, if anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. You heard me say, I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you loved me, you would be glad that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. I will not speak with you much longer, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold on me, but the world must learn that I love the Father, and I do exactly what my Father has commanded me. I don't know if watching or listening, you heard a standard that Jesus set, a benchmark that Jesus set. And the question for us is, in daily life, how do we demonstrate our gratitude for who Jesus is and what he has done for us? He has given his life on the cross. He who never sinned died on the cross so that his holiness, which is infinite as God, might pay for the sinfulness of all who look to him by faith and say, Lord, forgive me, be my Savior, forgive my sin. And this is what he has done for us. And Jesus says, if you love him and have gratitude for this thing that he has done for us, this is what you are to do in daily life to demonstrate it. Jesus says it repeatedly in verse 15. He says, if you love me, you will obey what I command. He repeats in verse 21, whoever obeys my command, he is the one who loves me. In verse 23, if anyone loves me, he or she, generic, but the person, will obey my teaching. Verse 24, whoever does not love me will not obey my teaching. He states it in the negative. Whoever does not love me will not do my teaching. And then in verse 31, having said this four times, if you love me, if you have gratitude for what I've done, you will obey my teaching. He connects it at the end in verse 31 with himself as a role model. A good leader never asks of his followers to do something that the leader wouldn't do. He says in verse 31, I do exactly as my Father has commanded me. As I, Jesus, show my love for my Father by obeying what he has led me to do and has commanded me, you, my followers, are to love me and obey my teaching. Our benchmark as Christians in everyday life, what we are to aspire to, though we won't ever be perfect, but what we are to aspire to is to love Jesus, show our gratitude for what he has done by, in everyday life, obeying his teaching. And this is so important on so many levels. Again, it doesn't rescue our soul to do good deeds or to obey Jesus. Our soul is rescued by the love of Christ, given his life given on the cross for our sin, and our choosing to place our faith in him as our Savior, choosing to believe his sacrifice, his payment before God for my sins, is what rescues us. But how do we demonstrate our gratitude for his love, giving his life on the cross? How do we show our love returned to him? We obey his commands. according to Jesus, we obey his teaching. From the moment we claim him as our Savior, we seek to obey his teaching for the rest of our life. We are committed for the rest of our life to aspire to the benchmark of obeying the teaching of Jesus. We learn what he has taught through reading the scripture, and we apply it to our life in our words, in our deeds, in our attitudes, in our inner purity, in our inner motivations. In every sense, we obey the commands and teaching of Jesus. You know, we humans, it's political season, I guess, and we humans are fooled by words. But we can remember a standard. If someone says they're a Christian, even if they're a big name on television, for instance, if they claim to be a Christian, a follower of Christ, but they don't adhere to his teaching and follow after him in the way that they live, they may not actually be someone we should support and we should follow. We can hear the words of Jesus and discern the truthfulness of someone. It isn't words, it's the genuineness, the behavior, the choices made by a people, a person. So in the same way, we are to be genuinely grateful, genuine and sincere, obeying the teaching of Jesus, following what he has taught, and seeking to live under it and under his teaching, because he is over us, he is the Lord of our life. I climbed Mount Jackson many years ago up in New Hampshire. It's right by Crawford Notch, across from the AMC headquarters. I took a friend with me. And this friend's son was an assistant to the governor of a state. I'm not going to say what state, I'm not going to say the governor, I'm not going to say any names in this story, but my friend who was hiking with me that day, his son was an assistant to the governor of a certain state. And as we were driving, my friend was the passenger, he got a text message, and it said, "Dad, I'm so excited. I'm going to be in a meeting in a few minutes with the governor and with Reverend so-and-so and Reverend so-and-so. I can't wait to meet them." We kept driving up to New Hampshire, and a little while later, my friend got another text, and he looked at his phone, and he looked at me with a funny look on his face. And he looked at his phone, and he read the text to me, and I don't have the exact quote, but it was like this: "Dad, I can barely think straight. I'm now in the hallway outside where the meeting is. I had to step out and catch my breath. I am so shocked and disappointed. I have never been in a meeting with the governor or anywhere else and heard such foul language. These men curse every other word." And he filled in to his father some of the language that was being used, which obviously I would never repeat. And my friend looked at me with disgust and said, "So many people look up to Reverend so-and-so and Reverend so-and-so. They're fake." James chapter 3, verse 1 says, "Not many of you should aspire to be teachers, brethren, knowing we receive the greater scrutiny." And in two passages, in 1 Timothy and in Titus, Paul the Apostle spoke of how a leader should be, but the only reason I use that example and the only reason I bring in the scripture which I'm about to read of how a leader should be is that it's applicable to every Christian. We are all called to be under the teaching of Jesus in our words, in our attitudes, in our choices, in our actions, in our inner person. We're to have the right motivation. We're to be putting Christ first in our behavior and our words and in all that we choose to do, the places we're seen, the things we do, whatever it might be. And in Titus, Paul is addressing leaders in a church, but what he says is applicable to all of us. An elder must be blameless, the husband of but one wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer is entrusted with God's word, he must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he, and this is applicable to all of us, we must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught. Paul meant his teaching of the gospel and an expansion on it, so that he may encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. We are to be righteous. We are to be kind. We are to be patient. That's hospitality. We are to be generous. We are to think of the interest of others. We are to live by the teaching of Jesus. We can read Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, the Sermon on the Mount, one of the longest, along with this in John, the longest message and teaching, uninterrupted teaching of Jesus. Read it over and over and over and do our best to practice it until some of it becomes a habit as we respond and as we choose and we speak as Jesus teaches us. How do we show our gratitude and our love for Him and for what He's done for us on the cross in rescuing us by giving His life in our place for our sin? We obey His teaching sincerely, striving, aspiring to His benchmark in everyday life. Now, in our human state, we could not possibly do this. But Jesus repeats three times a great promise in this passage, and that is that we won't have to do this all by ourselves. Jesus promises that when He ascends to heaven, He will send the Holy Spirit, and if you catch it in a verse there, He will live in us, therefore teaching us God's truth and empowering us. The Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, will teach you, the church, all things, and will remind you of everything I have said to you. The Holy Spirit will indwell the believer and lead us to God's truth, teach us God's truth, and give us the ability, as we walk with Him, to change over time and grow in our walk and in our obedience as He works with us and we learn what it means to obey the teaching of Jesus and what it truly means to love Him, show our gratitude, and be a Christian. And Jesus explains here that the Holy Spirit will represent the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He will indwell us. Verse 26, He will abide within believers and teach us God's truth. That's from the Scripture. He will draw our attention to the teaching of Jesus. He will open our spiritual eyes to see and understand the teaching of Jesus. He will cause us to have a desire to learn the Scripture and spend time in the Scripture and learn the teaching of Jesus. He will give us a peace the world cannot give. And Jesus emphasizes that He's going away, and He's referring to two goings away. One is to the cross, then He will come back resurrected, but then after on the 40th day He will ascend to heaven and He will send the Holy Spirit to be present with believers. So in everyday life, and whether you're watching or here in person, have you ever read any of the Bible? I see two people nodding yes. If you've ever read the Bible, whether from outside or inside, that's the work of the Holy Spirit, because there is nothing in there that attracts us without the work of the Holy Spirit. As a believer, as a follower of Christ, have you ever felt something not quite right toward the end of the day because you haven't spent time in the scripture or in prayer, you haven't prayed and you haven't thought about it, that's the Holy Spirit reining us in and saying, come back, spend your time with doing the most important thing of the day, spending it with God the Father. The Holy Spirit operating on us to go to the Word of God. If we ever hear teaching or preaching, even the most humble there is, if we understand and learn something about God, that's not the preacher. That's the Holy Spirit working on us so that we can receive God's truth and apply it to ourselves. If we have ever had someone speak to us angrily, and if, like me, you're the type of person who, when somebody's rude, a stranger is rude at a gas station or something, or someone speaks angrily, you want to be rude back and say something angry. But if you've ever held back and been the peacemaker, that's the Holy Spirit who is changing our heart so that we're more like Christ. If someone has hurt us, and instead of hurting them back, we love them and pray for them and seek to forgive them. That's the Holy Spirit changing our heart so we're in submission to and practicing the teaching of Jesus, who said, forgive as you have been forgiven. Love your enemies. Pray for those who despitely use you and persecute you. Those are the Holy Spirit changing us, softening us, making us more merciful and loving, more like Jesus. He sets a benchmark out of gratitude for what He did to rescue us, giving His life on the cross. We are to be grateful. We are to love Him as He has first loved us. And we demonstrate that in everyday life, in our family, in our home, in our work, wherever we may be, whoever we're interacting with, we do it in everyday life, obeying Jesus, applying His teaching. In our motives, our inner person, our purity of thought and heart, in our words, our choices, our attitudes, our behavior. And Jesus says, I'm sending you help. When you receive me as Savior, the Holy Spirit will indwell you, representing the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We, through the Holy Spirit, will indwell you, and the Holy Spirit will draw you to God's teaching and teach you the Word of God and how you ought to be as a person. We always feel like, what do I have to do for God? But it isn't what we do first, it's who we be. He wants us to be followers of Christ and live by His teaching. Well, the other thing that He's repeating in this passage is that He is going away. And through this passage, along with the idea of submitting and obeying His teaching, is His gently preparing His disciples for His death and His resurrection, and getting them to understand that His death and then His resurrection will be a great gift that He gives not only to them, but to the world. He's been speaking to His followers for some time about His death and resurrection. They haven't been fully understanding. Here He speaks of it ever so gently again. In verse 2, He had said He was going to His Father's house, and He would come and retrieve His followers and bring them to a place He had prepared for them. And He repeats in verses 18 and 19 here, He will leave and return to them. That's His crucifixion and His resurrection. And then He will leave and send the Holy Spirit to come. And it's a blessing, He says, when He goes to be with the Father, meaning to stay, because He will send the Holy Spirit to be with His followers. He pays the penalty for sin on His death on the cross in His first going away as His death, and then sends the Holy Spirit so that we may be prepared for the eternal life we will have in the kingdom of heaven. I shared a story a few months ago as a sermon illustration about a guy in high school I had a problem with. We almost got in a fight. And I shared how some 30 years later I had met him. I think it was here in Foxborough at Founders Day, and I met this guy or saw this guy, and immediately when I saw him, I felt a great resentment and anger for that incident in high school that happened over 30 years before. And I shared in that illustration how I, as a Christian, knew that it was not right of me to have that attitude. And I had asked God to change my heart toward that guy. It wasn't the type of thing that I might go to him and ask his forgiveness, but I just knew that my attitude was off and I needed to let that go. I needed to forgive him and I needed to love him. And I shared how later I met him another time after that and I felt no resentment. God had changed my heart toward that classmate. And I now felt nothing but the very best for him and had a nice conversation with him. I opened the paper yesterday and there he was, 62 years of age. His life is over. Here are his survivors. Here is his visiting hours. Here is his mass. And I was so shocked and sad to see that, really sad to see that, because of what I had internally struggled with in relation to him. And I was thankful God had made it right in my heart while he was still living. And I grabbed my phone and I texted another classmate and I said, "Hey, did you hear he died?" And I said, "I heard he had cancer." My classmate I texted not 2 minutes later, texted back and said, "No, I hadn't heard that. And as a matter of fact, this is my fourth day in the hospital. I have colon cancer." This life goes by like that, ever so quickly, ever so rapidly. What the old people used to say when we were kids turns out to be true. It goes by like that. And Jesus says, don't waste it, this life, on the things the world thinks are so important that we'll leave behind and really are meaningless. Love me, follow me, secure your faith in me so that your eternity is all set and I will come and take you to the place where I am, where you will be forever. And he says, if you love me, if you have gratitude, live your life in a way that will add immeasurably to the quality of your life. Obey my teaching. Learn my teaching. Do my teaching. And I will send the Holy Spirit, and he will come, and he will help you. And when this life is over, you will be in the kingdom of heaven forever. Because of what Jesus does, when our moment comes, and our loved ones are assembled to say their last goodbyes and pay their final respects, Jesus says, you will be with me already in the kingdom of heaven forever and ever and ever. Could we pray together? Maybe you'd like to repeat a prayer after me this morning, just to affirm your faith. Heavenly Father, this is me. You know who I am because you made me. Thank you that you sent Jesus into the world to pay for my sin. Thank you that you love me as you love all people everywhere. Secure my hope, I pray, in you through your Son, Jesus. Forgive my sin. Give me a place in your kingdom. And Father, may I live the life of love, loving all people and obeying you as you have taught me. Father, thank you for each person who's watching today. They are part of one church through Jesus Christ. Thank you for these who are present. We live in a world that is hurting and in trouble. Father, so work that by faith in you, we may be a light to the world around us as we sincerely aspire to your benchmark and live under the teaching of Jesus, our Lord, in this life and in eternity to come. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of kings. Praise forever to the King of kings.
Thank you for your service to us this summer, Faith. Thank you for being here to worship the Lord together. Our goal as followers of Christ is to learn his teaching and practice it in the world. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be yours in abundance. Amen.